Good choice. So do you feel like do you ever feel like you've left behind anything, like you've left anything on the table, like creatively? Because I know one of the things that I think maybe we all struggle with is that, like, eventually there comes this point in your life where you just know that it's your time to go, right? And you leave behind your studio, you leave behind your network of artists, friends and colleagues and collaborators. You leave behind the galleries and the influences, and you have to land someplace that works for you and your family. And you have to reinvent yourself while also staying connected. And that, I think that's what interests me about you, is that, like, every step of the way, you've been able to take a piece of your previous experience and bring it to your new geography and kind of, like, acknowledge the new space, but also bring something along and reinvent who you are now. And I guess that's maybe the next chapter that we might want to talk about is, what's it like in Rhode Island? How are you adapting to that? Like, who is the new Kris Chatterson? We had the Florida Kris Chatterson, we had the Los Angeles Kris Chatterson, we had the Brooklyn Kris Chatterson. Now we have the Rhode Island Kris Chatterson. And I find that interesting. Can you talk about that transition?
If we could backpedal just a bit, I would love to hear from Kris actually what his inspirations were early on. Was it artists? Was it you said it was a lot of the surf world design, but when I look at the work, I see that there's like I always think of Gerhard Richter, Peter Deutsch, and the way he recycles material, even like Christopher Wool with the brushstrokes. Like, if these aren't in your realm, but like who really sort of kicked it off for you? Like, when you saw the art, you're like, oh wow, I want to do that. And that could be, a designer who made something in a magazine too. It doesn't have to be some blue chip artist.
That's a tough question, because I didn't come to art looking at art. I came to art through making it, because
Interesting.
I was always making stuff, and I don't know how to describe it, other than I would have visions and I would just try to get it out on paper, and they would be all sorts of things. So sometimes it would be, on the surf side, drawings of waves, which is, that's typical, like, teenage infatuation stuff. But then I was like doing like geometric patterns, or trying to, I knew there was a such thing as abstraction, but I didn't really know much about it. It was not around me. The way it's portrayed in popular culture is, I don't know, it's not favorable. It's kind of seen as this, who or why would someone do that kind of thing, or oh, my kid could do that. But I don't remember the artist's name, but I had a really great high school art teacher who, she would go, there's that, the art institution or foundation in New Smyrna. It's like the Atlantic something. New Smyrna Beach, they have a residency where they have an artist come, and then other artists come and work underneath this artist. I'm forgetting the name,
I forget the name of it.
but
Rod would know if he was on the call.
So, but she would bring the artists that were doing the people would come to the residency for, she would bring them to the high school. I don't know how she did it, because it definitely wasn't a part of their gig, but she would somehow talk them into coming and doing a talk. And we had this one artist, I don't remember his name, but he's like a real, like, Manhattan, like, New York artist, which, like, at the time of being in, a little small town school in Florida, was like a big deal. It's like, oh, New York, all right. But he basically, before he showed his work, because it was abstract work, he set a context, and he did a quick kind of like history of abstraction and like how it came to be, and like contextualized like why abstraction happened and how it happened. And it's not just random bits of this or that to make something, look interesting, but rather that there was a history and a context behind it. And it blew my mind. I was like, oh, So there is this is a thing. Like, I'm not crazy, and it's not just something, you know, that people do and it, laugh at it or whatever. So, and that's where I learned about like Kandinsky, more about Picasso, because in popular culture, Picasso is the Cubist stuff, but there's more abstract work that he was showing that kind of led into the work of like Kandinsky and Malevich and Modrian. And that's where I was like, oh, there's a lot more to this. And then I remember he did like a portfolio thing where he would like look at the other students' work and kind of critique it. Most of the students were like really disappointed with what he had to say, just because, you know, he was being honest. But then he like gets to me and he's like, oh yeah, you need to find your way to art school like now. Like, just, well, I'm not gonna say anything, but just go make sure you find your way to art school. And I just, that was a message I kept hearing anytime I would show my work to someone in the field. So I can't pinpoint where I saw something and was like, ooh, I want to do that. It was more like I would meet people and they would say, you need to keep doing this and find your way to in a place where you'll get the support you need to develop it.
Right. I always felt like, you know, the time that I spent in graduate school, that's the time where you find your voice, right? You study art history, you study your influences, but you ultimately try to get away from them. But is there still, when you think about artists that might inspire you, is there anybody out there right now that, like, maybe it's historically or someone in a contemporary vein that inspires you? Is there anything you're looking at?
Not looking at, but someone who I just admire just because of who they are and how they work is Joanne Greenbaum. Mm-hmm. Her, every time I see her shows, it's different work that's in it strong, and I'm always surprised. There's always a painting or two where I'm just like, where did this come from? And in a good way, you know, in a way that's, you know, I'm like, you know, impressed with, I guess. But I think that's the artist that, you know, I'm not the kind of artist that looks at a lot of other artists to try to get inspiration. That we can get back to the sort of the self-generative processes of like looking back at other work I made and like bringing it into what's happening. But I'm not the kind of artist with like a ton of artist books and things like that, trying to like pull from other people that way.
Right. Yeah.
There was a moment there in Brooklyn though, with, there was a almost like a camp of artists looking at imagery that they could source in a similar way. Like, I think of Kate Stechu and how she was finding images on the internet and reprocessing them and abstracting them and putting them up on a canvas. Same thing with Letha Wilson and making the three-dimensional objects she was making with photography and these found photos. And
yeah, I love Letha's work. Actually, my buddy Vince Contarino, we used to curate shows together, and we put her in a show.
Yeah, do you see a similar vein there? Am I just grasping at straws? I just feel like there's this moment back then where people were kind of looking at the analog versus the digital and how they were kind of processing it in different ways.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I totally see that.
Yeah.
Like for me, the work I was making in LA was very gestural based. At that time, I was like building these like big, you know, 16 to 20 inch wide brushes on huge canvases, mixing up big quantities of paint and like brushing these big brush strokes sort of composed together with color to make these, in a way, like to give someone like something to compare it to. I was thinking a lot about like old like Rubens paintings, which is more to me like a, if you want to use like a music term, like an orchestra of images kind of all stitched together to create this one big moving experience. I was trying to kind of get that impact inside of an abstract painting, but paring down the process of how it was done. So like by limiting my tools and by limiting my colors. I brought that process with me to New York, and you know, I was doing it for a while. It's something just wasn't clicking with me. Like to me, it felt out of step with New York in a way.
Right.
And I was kind of like needling and looking around the edges of my work and my process to see what or how I could change and like bring what I'm trying to do to New York, but let New York have an impact on me, you know? Because I was no longer in LA and I was no longer that artist or that person, right? And one day I was asked to do this peace poster. Now, anybody that knew me at that time when I was just getting into this transfer work, where I was starting to kind of go back into my old work at the time and gut it and resample it, would knows the peace poster story. So I'm sorry to those of you that have heard this 1,000 times, but it was that impactful, this experience. So I did this peace poster, and the premise was it had to be black and white and it had to have the word peace in it. So I sat down at the computer because that's the only place I knew where to start. And to backtrack a little bit to give a little context, when I was in LA, I had to work as a digital illustrator for an architectural rendering firm. What we did is we took CAD files from big architectural developments like KB Holmes or Toll Brothers, and rendered out the CAD design to look like almost like a photorealistic illustration to show prospective buyers, right, of the property or of the houses or the plans. So I have, you know, this sort of digital skill set within Photoshop and Illustrator and InDesign that I always kind of just used that as a way to make money, but I never brought it to my art until this point. And this is why it's through the process of making this poster, which at the time I was like, I was happy to do it because, you know, I was asked through friends who were asking other friends to do this, and it was a part of a portfolio. And I was like, great. I really wasn't, really didn't put too much stock into it until I started making it. And then what I was doing is I just sat down and typed the word peace. And then I made like a step pattern on the page, printed it out. And I was like, yeah, but that looks boring. It also looks like so much type treatments that I've seen before, especially at the time. So I printed it out and I cut it up with scissors and I scanned it back in and I manipulated in Photoshop a little bit and I printed it back out and I cut it up and then I started pasting it on a board and scanned it back in. I was being like, because you can do all of that stuff in the computer anyways. I was purposefully making the steps a little more difficult, a little more analog by printing it out and physically working with the material to have a different kind of connection than the what I'll call like the more slippery connection to what you have when you're working with a digital file. I wanted to have a tactile kind of control over the medium or the substrate of the paper and the print. And I found myself kind of halfway through this process, really enthralled with the process of doing it. And I was like, if I could just do this with abstraction, this would be great. Like, this would be amazing. This is like a really new and exciting way to think about making work and working with my own work. So, and this idea of being self-generative, of thinking about like programs and processes within a computer to then output and then put on a canvas that was painted. That to me was what was exciting. But at the time, after making that poster, I kind of sat on it for a little while because I couldn't figure out how to, at least a way that made sense for me logistically, to get the image from the computer.